Okay, welcome. My name is Hans Verkouw. I live and work in Norway, but I'm very much Dutch. And I was invited here to speak a little bit about Video for Linux. One question. Anyone knows what Video for Linux is? Okay, not too bad. Better than expected. I had no idea what to expect as audio audience knowledge about this. So I've been working on Video for Linux for, 8 years or 9 years, whatever, first as a hobby and the last 4.5 years as part of my daytime job. And first question is, what the hell is it? So it was webcams and TV capture cards support in kernel, in the Linux kernel. Later, things like radio capture was added, radio data system support, teletext, video output, encoders, decoders, advanced systems on the chip. High definition TV is very important for us, for Cisco. What isn't it? It's not graphics card support. That's DRM, display render management. It's also not the digital video broadcast receivers that you can, or lots of USB devices that you can just plug into your laptop or whatever. Those are a separate API. Now, I have, that's historical DVB. I think it should have been part of Video for Linux, but DVB was added at a time that there was very little or no maintainership of Video for Linux, and I think it just slipped through or. It depends who you ask to ask that. The DVB maintainers really think it's the best thing since bread, but I'm not that convinced myself. There is some overlap between the various subsystems in the kernel. So DVB, ALSA, DRM, frame buffer support. There is always a little bit of overlap because video capture, you know, you capture your video, you also capture audio. So you have volume controls, which are also in ALSA. Video output can be done through a DRM, through a frame buffer device, but also through Video for Linux. It depends on your use case which one is the best approach. But there is overlap here, and there is particularly between Video for Linux and the graphics, the people working on GPUs and the APIs for that. There is some cooperation these days to see if we can share some code and do things a little bit smarter. So the original hardware that Video for Linux had. Oh, by the way, as you can see, the first API is pretty old. It's now almost exactly 15 years old. So that makes it definitely one of the older subsystems. This was the first version of the API that is no longer supported since a year or so. It's completely removed from the kernel. And the second version appeared about six, seven years later. And that's what everything is using these days. So your typical hardware. So it's sort of two schemes. The first one is your typical TV capture card. So you have a tuner, analog video decoder, some PCI or USB bridge for doing the DMA. And then you have your video node through which you control it. The other one is a typical webcam with a sensor, a USB bridge, and a video node. All very simple, life was easy, everyone was happy. And then those pesky systems on the chip appeared. And this is the OMAP 3. It's by now fairly old, but this was one of the first that was fully supported in Video for Linux. So certainly you have multiple sensors, two serial sensors. You can attach a parallel sensor, complex video processing, previewers, resizers, statistics collections. Most importantly, different paths through which the video can go. So you can choose to get a raw image straight into memory. You can choose to let it go through a previewer. You can choose to have it go to a previewer, then a resizer, and then in memory. You can have data going just through the previewer, just through the resizer, or both. So suddenly it's a lot more dynamic. Before, the video pipelines were very static. That's no longer the case. And this is actually relatively simple. This is one of the more recent systems on the chip, just showing the video part. And actually, this shows just the tip of the iceberg, because all of these blocks, they have more blocks inside. You can imagine that going from a simple webcam to something like this will need some work in the kernel. And that's basically what I've been trying to achieve for the past 4.5 years. So what are the typical properties of systems on a chip? Complex, multiple video and graphic streams going on at the same time. You need flexible video routing. Very important one is also that applications need a lot more control. Your typical webcam or TV capture card acts very much like a TV in your home. So you have some sliders that allow you to change the brightness and the contrast and the volume. That's about it. All the intelligence on how to translate that to a good picture quality is done inside the TV. For an embedded system, you are the TV. So your software presents that GUI to the end user. And changing the brightness will mean that your application running on the Linux will need full control to the hardware in order to program it to get the best picture quality. And that's exactly where vendors do their value-added stuff. You know, one vendor wants to have the perfect quality. The next vendor wants just to be the first out to the market. Depending on your requirements, you may need to focus on one thing or another thing. So the full hardware capabilities need to be exposed to user space in an embedded system. Whereas your typical user really doesn't want to have to fill in color space conversion matrices. They're not interested. They don't want to do that. You just want to change the brightness. So that's a very important difference that we have. Where is it used? Well, pretty much everything you can imagine. TVs, digital cameras, smartphones. And it was not supported by Video for Linux. About 4.5 years ago, there was just no support for that. What's the consequence of that? Very few vendors want to do it the right way, so they just hack their way around it, make proprietary drivers, and they don't care. And they wanted to change that. One of the drivers for that was Texas Instruments at the time. So we started out around 2008 with some talks. We had some review RFCs, lots of discussions during conferences. There are some really, if you're interested in this part, a sort of three main conferences each year: the Linux Plumbers Conference, and the Embedded Linux Conference in Europe, and the one in the US. So those are the sort of the three main conferences that are really good for these types of meetings. We also had ad hoc mini summits, just get some people together and brainstorm how you do things. And this basically been ongoing from 2008 up to 2012. And actually, in about a week, we will have another meeting. So what was done through all that time? One of the main things that were missing is, okay, you have all these complex things. So in order to support that, you first need to have proper infrastructure. And there was very, very little at the time. Some of the really most basic things didn't exist. So probably the first year was spent adding those infrastructure parts. So you needed a top-level structure, pulling everything together. Very important one was something called a subdev. Typically, Video for Linux hardware, they all have the same pattern. So you have a bridge chip. That can be a system on a chip. It can be a USB chip or a PCI Express chip. They're talking to some bus, getting the video data to memory. Next to that, you have a whole bunch of I2C devices, which are separate chips that you put on your board to do the video capture part or video output or audio mixers or video improvement chips. You have a wide range of devices there. So you have a constellation of devices that you all need to control. In systems on a chip, you often have similar devices that are part of the system on the chip itself. So what was created was a structure that allows you to abstract those devices. And it was called Subdevice, still not the best. Nobody ever came up with a better name. And that made it possible to write a driver that was pretty independent of what bus was being used. And it was very good for reusability. So one and the same driver could be used in a USB device, could be used in a PCI Express device on the embedded system. And it all works. Before that, we actually had multiple competing APIs. So if you wrote a driver for one API, it would be unusable for another. And that really blocked reusability. Another one that was missing is that was really simple, just a simple struct to represent a file handle, an open file handle. Sounds very simple, but just these little structs make it possible to do all sorts of fancy stuff in an infra, in a framework. Because you have sort of an abstract API that you can use there. It's very much like C++. These are sort of your base classes. And you can build very nicely on top. Another very important part that required a lot of work. This is actually old stuff. Lots of the Video for Linux drivers, they have something called controls, which are basically just knobs that you can turn a brightness, contrast, volume. But it can also be more complex things like a bitrate for an MPEG encoder. Problem was that the API became fairly complex for that. And drivers all did it themselves, and some drivers were fairly good, others were pretty bad. Basically, it was very inconsistent what was happening. So that was another part where we needed a good framework to have drivers just do it. Basically, register their controls and provide a function on how you set the controls in the hardware, and that was it. And the framework would take care of all the rest of the work. So that was done in 2.6.36, the first version, and some enhancements at 3.1. Another important one, the original TV capture cards, they were all standard definition, PAL, NTSC, CCAM. It doesn't really work in the modern world, so you needed support for high definition TV. The original API was based on a preset ID, so you have presets for the common formats like 1080p 60, 720p 60. Nice idea, didn't work out in practice. We also had a way to do a custom timings, more or less like a mode line for an X server, where you actually specify all the timing parameters explicitly. And that turned out to be a much better way. So the preset API is now almost completely removed. There's just one more driver that uses it. And we're switching completely to the timings API. And that needed some additional work. For example, if you have an HDMI input, you want to be able to detect what format you're receiving. So you needed something to query that. So there was some additional work that needed to be done, and that went into 3.5. And this means that we can support all HDTV formats, but also all the formats that a typical PC will give you if you connect to a receiver. All the weird VGA formats that you have out there. Other thing that is specific to a lot of the connectors is things like EDID handling, which is what can your display handle, what formats. Hot plug, detecting that the cable is connected, and a bunch of other things that are specific to DVI and HDMI. It's a big mess, really, connectors. I don't know, they never can make it easy to people. So you have a whole bunch of different connectors, and they all have some features that they need, and they needed some support for that. And that's all in 3.7, that was very recent.
Anything like
HDCP? Not in this version. Someone is working on that. It shouldn't be too difficult, actually. I mean, this is, you know, we're not offering any protection. What usually happens is you buy a chip and it has hard-coded private keys that are in the hardware that you can never get in software, so you're pretty safe. But you are responsible for making sure you comply to all the licenses, HCCP licenses. But what the driver typically has to do there is just to get a list of the of some public keys or set them for a transmitter. There is no API for that yet. I think someone is working on that. It shouldn't be difficult. There's nothing preventing us from doing that. I'm working for Cisco. We are doing video conferencing. Video conferencing and ACCP, they don't live happily together because, you know, you connect a Blu-ray player, for example, you get encrypted video in, but you're not allowed to send it to a remote site. So you sort of defeat the whole purpose of video conferencing. So typically we don't handle encrypted video. That's why it's not in there, because I've been working mostly on this. But I know someone else who is looking into this. It's not a big deal, technically. The big deal is figuring out how to do it safely, and that's basically a legal issue and not a technical thing. It's the whole HTTP is completely ridiculous in my view, but I'm not a lawyer. Another thing that we needed were events. So what you typically want, you know, you plug in an HDMI cable, you want to get an event, hey, someone's connected. Ideally, we wanted to use Select. Video for Linux, you know, you open the device node and you capture frames, and it is nice if you can, through the same file handle, you can get exceptions saying that something has happened. So we did that work, works very well. It was merged in 2635, but we did some improvements to make it more reliable. In the first version, you could, in certain circumstances, lose events. In the latest version, you have real 100% reliability. That was done in 3.1. So now one of the main big remaining issues is all those dynamic video streaming. How do you do that? There was no support for that. So what we came up with was something called a media controller. And a media controller is a new device node. And it does very little. It basically tells you what your topology is of your hardware. So what are all the entities that are giving you or receiving video streams? What can they do? What are the links between them? And in many cases, links are what we call immutable, that's fixed. But sometimes you have multiple links and you can select which one is active. And the media controller basically just that. So it tells you what do you have. It tells you what are the possible links. And it allows you to change the links between entities. And that's it. So it's really very simple. It was made for video for Linux initially. But I know ALSA has quite interested in using this as well. You could use it for anything that has some sort of a topology in hardware. And it allows you to, as an application writer, it allows you to open it and see what the hell is going on, how does it look. So, well, basically this is it. So you have a media device, you have nodes. Nodes representing either a device node, that's where you eventually get your data from. Sub-devices, they can be sensors, resizers, whatever you have. And it will enumerate the possible and current links between entities and allows you to change it. And also the entity information will give you information on where the respective nodes are. So if you have a device node, it will give you a major and minor number, which you can give to the UDEV library, and then you get a /dev whatever that you can open. So it will actually tell you where everything is. And if you run that for, say, an OMAP3, then this block diagram is actually pretty much identical to the block diagram that I showed earlier from the OMAP3 processor. So if this is done correctly, then what you get from the media controller and the block diagram should be pretty much a one-on-one mapping. Now, you have to believe me here that this is actually the same, but if you compare them, then it will actually turn out to be the same. So this was actually, media controller was a really big chunk of work. It went in 2639, and we are really happy about it. It's it's pretty much the only way you can represent these really complex pieces of hardware. Other things that we did, we used to have, we still have it. It's a small framework called VideoBuf. All video drivers are all the same. So you queue up a number of frames, large buffers. The sensor or TV capture card will fill them up and give them back to user space. You process them and give them back again to the kernel. So you needed a way to administrate those buffers. And that's this framework. It's quite old. Whoever wrote it originally was high on some interesting drugs because it was absolutely horrible code. So a new version was written, not very originally named, VideoBuf 2. Really could have done something more imaginative. But this one is actually VideoBuf done right. And really important is that buffer operations and memory operations, which is how do you allocate the buffers, how do you make them available for a DMA engine, they're separated. They weren't in the first version. So if you had hardware with very specific memory properties that needed special handling, then you needed to almost copy the whole framework again in order to make it work. Now it's a lot easier. What it also made possible is multiplanar support. So your Y plane, which is the Luma data, can be in a different place in memory than the chroma plane, which is the color information. Usually, most hardware doesn't need that, but some hardware requires that. Particularly, certain Samsung chips, you want to put the Luma data in one memory bank and the chroma data in another memory bank in order to improve throughput. But VideoBuf 2 made it easy to add multiplanar support, so we have that now as well. What has also made it much easier is to create memory-to-memory devices, which is typically encoders and decoders. So you give it an uncompressed frame and it will be compressed and you get a compressed frame back, or vice versa. So this was a pretty cool piece of work. What else do we have? Codec support and flash. Flash is not referred to flash memory. It refers to the flash on your digital camera, by the way. So we had some support for codec where you could set up parameters for H.264, MPEG, DivX, whatever. This is extendable, so H.265, whenever that comes around, it can, you can just plug in the parameters that you need and you're done. Support for flash controllers was added. JPEG compression, there was a really ugly API in the past and that's now been updated, something much nicer. You can see it goes on and on. Selection support, cropping and composing is much improved. Radio support. There are some USB devices that can do FM and AM.
DAB.
DAB. We don't actually. DAB support is not in the kernel at the moment. Nobody bothered to actually write a driver for it. If we do, it will almost certainly be part of the DVB framework because it has many similarities for that.
Well, those chips are fairly popular software radio chips for Linux, but then the DAB functionality isn't used.
Someone needs to do the work.
Yeah.
You're volunteering?
No.
So that's one reason that so much work has gone into this. It's very simple. SoCs are used in smartphones. That's a big market. Companies like Samsung have been very, very active in this and still are very active in improving this support because they want just to run Linux, Android on the smartphones out of the box. They understand how it should be done. And so there is a lot of money there that is being poured into this work. This would never have happened if it wasn't for smartphones. The market is otherwise just, there's not enough money probably to put into all the engineers that have been working on this. And before this happened, Video for Linux was just, hobbyists. I bought a TV. That's how I started as well. I bought a TV card and I wanted to get better support out of it. So you didn't have data sheets because companies never released them. Those few weirdos that were doing that on that weird OS called Linux, or are we not going to support them? So it is really only happened when systems on a chip were going to be used in smartphones using Androids that this took off. Before that, you did have a lot of support for Linux and servers and networking stuff, but not for video. It was too much of a niche market.
But there's also, of course, lots of programs doing software.
Oh yeah, I mean a lot of this stuff. Sometimes JPEG compression can do in software and hardware. If you have hardware, you know, then you want a driver for it. But on a consumer piece of hardware, you don't care because your PC is fast enough to do it in software. On the smartphone, you really want to put it off to a piece of hardware, because you save energy that way.
Yes.
So things, I mean, you, I don't know of any current consumer device that does JPEG compression, not since 10 years, I think. But this has become popular again for smartphones, because you just want to save all the CPU cycles and just farm it off to some hardware block that can do it much cheaper. So we've been working on radio supports for multiple frequency bands. Recently some work was done. Actually this is not so much in the kernel itself as in a supporting library for radio data system decoder. Again, radio data system, you know, it's quite popular, particularly in cars. But you also see it a lot on smartphones with an FM receiver that can also do RDS. And there never was a proper decoder library that actually worked. So this is very nice to... It's almost finished. This has been one of the biggest issues, actually, memory handling. Video buffers, they take a lot of memory. So a 1080p frame is about 4 to 6 megabytes, depending on your color space. That's just one buffer. And most of the hardware, it's getting better, but still a lot of hardware out there needs physically contiguous memory for that. So you can't use virtual memory where the pages are all over the place. No, it must be one contiguous piece of memory in your memory banks. Problem with Linux is, as the moment you boot, it starts fragmenting the memory. So that's sort of okay if you need 32 kilobytes of memory, that's no problem. But these large buffers, that becomes a problem very quickly. And companies used to do all sorts of fancy stuff, like reserving, mostly some variant of reserving memory at boot, and then writing your own memory allocator to get these buffers. Nobody liked that, they were all incompatible solutions. So what we ended up with is the contiguous memory allocator. Samsung did all the work, and I think it took a year and a half. The patch series got up to version 22 or 23 before it was ever accepted, so but that's quite a lot of patch revisions. It was merged in 3.5, and the cool thing about it, what you do, let me go to the next slide. So this is your physical memory, and you reserve or mark a piece of that memory, the blue one, as CMA, usable by CMA. And you can just, when you allocate something, you can just use that memory as normal. But when you allocate, you tell it, okay, now I want to have a piece of physically contiguous memory for my video buffer, then that will use CMA memory, and so in this case it wants this piece of memory. Problem is, there are two pages used there. And what is special about this memory? Sure, you can use it for pages, but only for pages that you can either drop or move away. So if you try to allocate physically contiguous memory here, then the memory allocator is actually able to move these pages away to another place, and hey, you have your memory. you have a bit of extra overhead because, you know, the memory has to be moved. But you have sort of the best of two worlds. On the one hand, if you don't need the buffers, then the memory is still usable by other processes. But if you do need it, then you're able to get it. Of course, it might be that, you know, your memory is really full and it can't move it anywhere, then, but that's just out of memory, just like normal. Can't protect against that. So this is actually really cool and a very nice way to get the buffers that you need in an elegant manner.
So kmalloc cannot take memory from the physical, the contiguous memory area. It has to take
no.
From the
regular. It takes it, kmalloc allocates physically contiguous memory.
Yes.
But it since it fragments, you can use kmalloc to get 8 megabytes, but if it's not available, then it won't be able to do it.
But pages that you want to allocate in the kernel, but not that you want to allocate in the kernel via kmalloc, but you are not doing small pages, will normally not be taken from the contiguous memory pool.
Does kmalloc get it from CMA? I'm actually not sure about that. I don't see. Probably not.
The kernel has, once it's allocated, the pointer is fixed. It's only known by the driver that does kmalloc.
So yeah, so I don't think it can move pages away if they're kmalloc. So kmalloc will get its memory from the non-CMA area. I'm not 100% certain, by the way, because I didn't. It's Samsung that wrote this, and I'm, you know, before you really are a memory allocation expert, you're a few months further along with a lot of study. That's one of the really tricky parts of the kernel. Oh, yeah. It's available for every driver. I think it's fairly automatic, actually. It depends on your architecture. Not all architectures support it at the moment. It's done pretty automatic, I believe. Whenever you call, DMA alloc coherent or DMA coherent alloc, one of those functions where you really tell the system, I need physically contiguous DMA memory. If the architecture supports CMA, and that's currently the ARM, then it will use CMA for that. But I don't think I don't believe it's been ported to Intel. They've tell me that it's not difficult, but you know, someone needs to need it and do the actual work. Yeah, so from what I gather, my understanding is that it's actually not hard to add it to another architecture, but it sort of happens automatically when you request that type of memory. So another big one, and that is currently still in progress. Let me see how much time. Oh, pretty good. Zero copy pipelining, that's sort of the holy grail. So you capture from a sensor and you want to put that straight into a texture that is being output through OpenGL to your desktop or whatever, without ever having to copy from one buffer to another. This is an interesting problem because now suddenly different subsystems have to cooperate. They have to understand memory allocated by one subsystem and be able to handle that. This was done mostly through the Linaro organization, which is a non-profit organization that wants to promote ARM support in system on a chip, and they do a lot of kernel work and use space work to have that CPU supported better. That sort of was sort of ideal because they are, you know, vendor agnostic, and they did a lot of the early work for that. So a DMA buff API was created, and what it does, it can represent a buffer allocated by a driver through a file handle. And the nice thing about file handles is you can actually, they are already reference counted, so you know when the last file handle is closed, so you can release the memory. And you can actually give a file handle to another process. So if you have multiple processes that need to work together with a file handle, you can use that. And what the idea is that your API for, say, graphics cards or for a video for Linux device stays pretty much the same. But if you have allocated the buffer, you can export it as a file handle. And you can also import that file handle in another driver. So that allows you to pass the buffer from one device to another device. This is implemented, I believe, for the Intel graphics chip at the moment. I'm not 100% certain whether it's already in the kernel. I believe so. And patches exist for Video for Linux that do the same thing, and we expect them to be merged in hopefully 3.8. And then you suddenly have a way to actually allocate in one driver, give the buffer directly to another driver, without ever having to copy, to actually copy from one buffer to another. Before, buffers were always owned by the driver who needed them, who allocated them, so you couldn't share. What you still have to ensure, of course, is that the contents of those buffers are understood by both. Otherwise, you get garbage in one driver, and we can't protect against that. Some other things that are in progress, consumer electronics control, that sorry.
It was already possible to do zero copy in Video for Linux,
right? Only, not really. Only if you had support for user pointers. But they are not physically contiguous. The problem is usually with physically contiguous buffers. Typically, if you have multiple devices, then they each have their own memory requirements. Some of them can do scat together, so they can use virtual memory. Others need physically contiguous memory. And the idea here is that you have to pick the one with the most strict requirements. That's the one that needs to allocate the buffer. And then you can share it with another driver that has less strict, the same or less strict memory requirements. You shouldn't do it the other way around. You know, if you have a driver that where you allocate virtual memory, then a driver that needs physically contiguous memory can't use that because the pages are all over the place, so it doesn't work. Interesting problem there will be for a generic application how to figure out which one has the most strict requirements. I've proposed that you have virtual memory, physically contiguous memory, and playing weird, but people didn't like that. I think actually that's probably what you will need, because if you have really weird stuff, well, there are many degrees of weirdness in hardware. No more questions on this? Other things we're working on, I'm working on support for consumer electronics control. That's a pin on the HDMI connector. You typically see that in audio, video, say home cinema equipment, where if you change the volume on your TV, it will actually change the volume on your AV receiver. So it's an extremely ugly committee-designed API or to have different devices communicate with one another. It's 300 baud, something like that, sort of Stone Age. It does everything but the kitchen sink, and is actually quite complex to design for. But I've been working on that, and it will be, since it's something that you want to use for both graphics cards and for Video for Linux devices, and who knows, it can be a standalone USB dongle even. I'm working on making this a separate device node with its own separate drive. So this will not be part of Video for Linux as such. Another important thing I've been working on, a utility to test whether a driver actually complies to Video for Linux API. Video for Linux API is huge. It has latest count 83 ioctls. It does audio, video, encoding, decoding, you name it, it does it. Video is complex. There's no way around that. But we never had something that actually, okay, you write a driver and it sometimes it's very difficult to figure out whether you filled in all the fields of a structure correctly, whether everything is consistent, whether you didn't forget anything. So for the past 4 years, I think I've been working on a video for Linux compliance tool, which is now 90% complete. And almost no driver complies. Almost all of them have at least one or two things that are wrong. So this is actually, I wish we had this way earlier, because it's actually quite difficult to do it right. And you really need a tool to make sure that you haven't forgotten anything. This is just ongoing development. It will be steadily improved even further. As you've seen from what I've told right now, a lot of things have happened. And this is a slide from almost exactly 3 years ago. This was the very first time I presented video for Linux, what the status is and the future. And this was right after probably the first big mini summit that we had. And so this was my to-do list at the time. As you see, this is in, 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 this is in. I'm done. I can go home. Well, not quite done. There is a lot of things still to be done. But everything that has to be done are now small things. You know, some hardware comes along with special requirements. You have to figure out how to fit it into the whole system. I'm sure you will be continually expanding it. But I'm very, very pleased that about almost everything that I set out to do is actually done. Thanks to a lot of work from companies, well, Samsung is very big. Nokia also did a lot, not anymore. They did a lot when they were still Linux friendly. The last video for Linux developer who worked for Nokia left for Intel 2 months ago. So that's history, I'm afraid, Nokia. But still, thanks to them, we have a media controller. They funded that work. So while it lasted, they did some really good stuff. That's it. Questions?
Is there a plan to merge the DVB API into the DVB Linux?
No. DVB, we really, okay, that's my personal opinion. We really need new developers for DVB, active developers. DVB, for whatever reason, Video for Linux has been, the Video for Linux community has been very, very active. Lot of very good cooperation as well. Within DVB, there are a few developers. And frankly, every time you suggest an improvement, they say, oh no, we shouldn't do that, that's risky, things might go wrong, and there's just nobody with a long-term view there. And I really wish there was some new blood coming into the DVB community to actually improve stuff. It's been stagnant, in my personal opinion. It's my opinion. And it's a shame. I personally think it's a shame that DVB exists at all. It should have been part of Video for Linux. DVB is 10 years old or something. So there's no chance of that changing. Well, I wish we had new developers who could just shake up things and do some long-term projects to improve it. Other questions? Yeah?
Compared to 3 years ago, I have the feeling that almost everything changed in Video for Linux. Did you consider just creating a new infrastructure from scratch instead of gradually?
Was it necessary? We looked at it, but it really, the Video for Linux 2 API is actually really, really good. Almost everything we did, I think about 80% of the work was actually not in the API, it was in infrastructure. Because right now, if you just do a simple word count for the infrastructure of Video for Linux and you compare that to some other subsystems, then we are sort of midway between the frame buffer devices and the GPUs, which I think is fair. That's sort of where I would expect it to be. Before that, we were tiny. We were less than frame buffer devices. There was just no internal, was just way insufficient internal framework and functions that you could use in the drive. So writing drivers was really hard You had to do almost everything yourself. And writing these complex drivers is way harder. So you just, a lot of work went into that. And the API changes, they were pretty much building on what was there already. New ioctls, but they all fit into the whole design philosophy of Video for Linux 2. There are a few cases where you, perhaps one or two cases where ioctls have been deprecated and going to, or where we made better versions, but they are far and few between. So it's actually been really well designed. The first version, Video for Linux 1, was really bad. But so they put in a lot of work in the second version, and that pays out. It was pretty forward-looking. So there's no Video for Linux 3 on the horizon. Other questions? No? OK, thank you very much.